Everyone, good evening. It is Mike and Wendy. Welcome to the Marriage Shop. Do not adjust your screens. This is a Dallas Cowboys hoodie that I am wearing. Yes. Mm. So I'm not trying to talk to anybody about that. Charmaine Williams. Anyway.
Oh my goodness.
It's good to be back. We missed you all.
Yes.
Yeah. And yeah. It seems like it's been a while, a long while. And so we've been all over the place. We've been thousands of miles and we've been in hot weather and cold weather, and mm-hmm. And now we're back here with you. That song you heard coming in was Johnny Gill, Me For You.
Yes.
And that is played in honor of my sister and her new husband. Help us congratulate Desrick and Andrea Lewis. Got married on Saturday, December 18th. So
yes, congratulations.
That was amazing. So yes. Really happy for them. Hey, let me see. Charmaine Williams, we already shouted you out.
Yay.
Hey,
Candace Terrell and Lori Simmons, thanks for joining us. Xavier Lucky Sr., Monica Butler, hey fam, and Dynasty Blue, long time no see. That baby boy is getting big.
I bet he is.
So thank you guys for joining us. We're glad to be back.
Yeah, and thank y'all for joining us on Martin Luther King Day. And some of us are old enough to remember when this holiday did not exist. And so we just honor everything that Dr. King stood for and for all of the change that continues to occur because he did what he did. So thank y'all for joining us. All right. So let's talk about where we've been. I mean,
Where we've been. Quick. So we've been all over. It was a great holiday season for us. Did a lot of travel. We went to, the Virginia Beach area or Hampton Roads area, depending on how you want to look at that. Got on the road, had some windshield time, as they call it, back in the day. We've been to Marco Island. We've been to New York most recently. I can't remember if we went anywhere else.
Well, the Marco Island thing was cool. Mm-hmm. I mean, shout out to Family Life and the Weekend to Remember speaker team and all the leaders and folks that make that happen. We spent I forget how many days, a bunch of days in Florida at a retreat and training, preparing for this upcoming speaking season with Family Life. And that was just like, wow, that was like amazing.
It was amazing. It was really amazing. We got to meet some really awesome people, awesome couples who are really kind of sold out for helping build marriages. And it was just a great experience overall. And the weather was amazing.
It was amazing.
Yeah. Yes.
So we hopped on a plane and the temperature was probably so at 75, 78, came home, grabbed up our daughter, shot over to Atlanta.
Yeah.
Hopped on a plane the next morning and landed in New York.
Yeah.
To what, 27 degrees or something like that?
Cold.
Oh my goodness.
It was night and day.
It was cold. After you know, at below 40, it's just all cold. It doesn't even matter. It's just all cold. Anyway.
Yeah. I mean, it was freezing. I mean, our daughter said we were being dramatic, but it was cold. It was like as soon as you walked outside,
just like
you didn't want to keep your eyes open.
Bite you.
I mean, it was bad.
You said you didn't want to keep your eyes open. That's
no.
Funny. Anyway.
No, it was bad. It was cold. And then it snowed.
We got pictures to prove it. That was something.
Yeah.
So anyway, but that was good stuff. And so tonight we just wanted to kind of jump right back in and really kind of keep it practical and real, if you will, tonight with something I think that impacts, I don't know, everybody.
Yeah, I think so. But before we do, thanks for joining us, Quintus George and Deborah Reed. We're glad you guys are joining us. And if you're joining us for the first time, we're Mike and Wendy Perry in the Marriage Shop. Every Monday, we try to come to you live on Facebook on this page. So glad you found us. And we're just talking about things that are either relevant in our marriage or in as people share with us, relevant in their marriages, but not unique to any of us.
Yeah.
So tonight, what are we talking about?
Well, tonight, you know, there's an old saying that, you know, you have to remember. I think it goes, you know, the main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing.
Okay, say that again.
The main thing is keep the main thing the main thing.
Okay, and so what are we talking about?
Well, I mean, tonight we're talking about it from the context of those little skirmishes that pop up, you know?
Yeah.
You know, skirmishes.
Fights.
Not quite fights. They never start out as fights, right? It's just a little, you know, something, a little
disagreement,
irritant, a little disagreement, a little something. And all of a sudden, you know, an hour later, you are way down the rabbit trail, like on something that you never intended to talk about in the first place. In fact, oftentimes something that perhaps you thought was over.
Yeah. Well, Michelle Moore Wilson, thanks for joining us. And Andrea Lewis, thanks for joining us. We love you. So it's real easy to go down that rabbit hole, particularly when one of us feels like we didn't resolve the last issue.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, but I don't, why would you, if the last issue isn't resolved, why would you be on the next? I mean, why not just resolve it? What's the problem with just resolving it? Yeah. Like in the moment?
Well, because I think that sometimes you think it's done, right? We're done talking about it, or we at least agree that we're done talking about it, but there's still some residual. There's something that sometimes there's something that's still yet unresolved, or sometimes people walk away from it not feeling like they were understood or they were heard. And so that thing tends to kind of trail until the next thing.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and so what are some reasons you think people walk away from something? Like maybe even knowing that it's not done, they know that in their heart of hearts, they really have a little piece of that thing left. Yeah. Why do they walk away?
Because they're tired.
What are you talking about?
Because, I mean, you can go in, you can have a discussion, you can talk about something, you know, like for hours.
Yeah.
And then it's just like, I just want this to be over. I'm tired of talking about it, tired of fighting about it. I just want it to be over. I'm done. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes people just get run down. They get tired. Mm-hmm. I think that's one reason. I don't know. You guys can tell us what are some reasons that you leave a disagreement or a small argument or difference of opinion, that you leave it not really having resolved it. and then you find yourself focused on that thing or it keeps coming up? What are some of those reasons?
Yeah. Please post those, because I mean, I think that's one thing that's pretty important, because you know, there's all kind of things that people carry around, and then all of a sudden, you know, you find yourself again in that argument, right? In that moment where things are kind of blowing up and you're like, man, what happened?
Yeah.
How do we get back here? I thought we resolved this.
Yeah. Like, you know? I thought we already talked about like having an argument or disagreement or conflict. Mm-hmm. Didn't we talk about that already?
Well, we talked about, I mean, yeah, but there's so many ways you can wrap this conflict thing. Right.
Okay. So we're back.
Yeah.
Talking about it again.
And well, I mean, because now it's about like, so we talked about kind of resolving conflict, right? But what is it that causes people to reach back and boom, right? That thing that you thought was done. And they're like, well, nah, you thought we were done, but no, we are not done.
Yeah. But is that this what we're talking over. About exactly?
Yeah. Cause that's not the main thing, right? Cause all of a sudden we thought it was the main thing.
Right. But that's not the main thing. That's not even what we're talking about tonight.
What are we talking about?
The main thing.
What's the main thing?
How difficult it is to keep the main thing when you're in the midst of an argument. Mm-hmm. And so how easily it is when you're in the midst of exchanging ideas.
Oh, it's idea exchange now. I love it.
When you're in the midst of it, how easily we can get distracted and we start to focus on other things, like your tone. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. And so then I'm mad or I'm upset or whatever. I'm resenting you because of the tone that you're using.
Mm-hmm.
And so then I go off on how you always, when we get into a disagreement, you always escalate or you get loud or you get whatever. And so then my issue
I'm sorry. So are we having this conversation right now? I mean, are you,
no,
are you just,
what
is this
we're
for
talking
example?
About is this is for example.
Oh, I mean, I'm just saying
how very... you could be talking about one thing. You could be talking about dinner, what's for dinner. And then it becomes, but you always, or you never,
right.
Or you,
what's wrong with your face?
What's wrong with your face?
So, okay. I'm sorry, but
that is how we so easily go from the main thing becoming something else.
It was so specific though. I was like, I mean, it seems like you were like telling me that right now, like right now. So I'm like, oh, what? Okay. Anyway, main thing.
The main thing. Yeah. So Monica Wilson Ferguson, thanks for joining us and happy birthday. So that you had a birthday this week.
Happy birthday.
She says both parties have their opinions and are not willing to compromise. So yes, that can keep us from moving forward or reconciling some things. And Michelle Moore Wilson says, you don't hear each other during the conversation. Mm-hmm. So one may feel that since they're not being heard, there is no further use to continue the conversation. So they're answering the question that you asked.
Yes.
You know, how is it that you move on from a conflict or disagreement without resolving it? So thank you, ladies. That was great.
Yeah, you know, and I mean, I've been there.
Yes, you have.
I mean, don't act like you ain't been there. You've been there. I mean,
been there.
But
I'm just
owning my, like, you know what? This is, you're not really hearing what I'm saying right now. And I'm saying it, you know, 10 different ways. None of them working. Forget it.
Yeah. We've all been there.
Yeah. So what you saying? I mean, are you trying to
I'm not saying anything.
Like,
so what's the main thing? What is the main thing?
What's the main thing? What?
That we're talking about tonight.
It's keeping the main thing the main thing.
Okay. And so what is it?
Well, I mean, it's different for everybody. But the point here, the main point tonight is a lot of times there can be residual things for some of the reasons that we're getting. Right. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, I'm going to put this down for right now. We're going to agree to disagree or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, maybe. But a lot of times that is setting up to bring something back later on. So with that, when whatever tomorrow's issue is, can't stay on that issue, right? Because all of a sudden you begin to relate things and connect things that sometimes are not even connected.
Yeah, that's true. But, you know, you've seen that thing where I think it's a comedian or it might be a pastor who's illustrating how men and women's brains work.
Mm-hmm.
And so he has like a box. And so in the man's box, there's like nothing in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, and their brains are just like you know, each thing has its own box or compartment in each thing. And that's all that is in each box. And mm-hmm. then in the woman's box, it's like this whole, like, ball of yarn looking thing where mm-hmm. everything in the woman's brain and mind is connected.
Yeah.
So each thing is connected. I mean, there's a lot of truth to that.
No, there's not.
Yeah, there is.
There is absolutely no truth.
There is.
The only truth to that is what he described is what we would like you to think, mm-hmm. right? And I don't care, man, whatever, man. You all say what you like. It's all connected. We just don't want to say it is because what does that look like? Man, you know, I don't like what you said to me and now that's affecting how I think, how I feel. And nobody's going to say that.
Yeah, but you maybe better believe. You should.
Maybe the truth is, mm-hmm. yeah, there is spillage and there are things that are connected and things that taint and you know, kind of create this cloud or whatever over other things.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
In fact, who was that? I reject the idea that my brain is an empty box.
It said that each thing or issue has its own box, its own compartment.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's developmentally. Like, over the course of time, that's kind of how we're often taught or trained or what we model. Mm-hmm. It's just not true. If you'd peel open, you'd peel it open.
Yeah.
For some people, it'd be an absolute jumbled mess in there, brothers, and you know it.
Yeah. But I think it is true, and ladies, you can let me know if it's true for you or not, that you do somehow string together each thing. Like each mm-hmm. thing that comes up is somehow interrelated to other things. Mm-hmm. Like you can draw a line and connect each mm-hmm. thing to something else. Tell me if that's true for you.
And brothers, I will not tell you to tell me if it's true, because mm-hmm. I'm not going to try to put you on blast. You're not going to tell me. I know.
I'm not putting them on blast.
I mean, I'm just saying, because for them to say, yeah, they have to say, yeah, all the stuff that we thought was true and that we put out there is maybe that's not altogether like 100% of the story.
Yeah.
I already know. So y'all don't have to tell me anything. I know. And if you want to argue with the point, if you want to like say you're wrong, Mike, say that.
Yeah.
I will take your silence as agreement. Thank you very much.
Okay. So in terms of mm-hmm. when you get into a disagreement or an argument or whatever, you're talking about an issue. Mm-hmm. And you know, you are going in, but all of a sudden you realize, one of you or both of you realize that what you're arguing about or whatever focused on is not what you started arguing about, or you can't even remember what it was you were fighting about in the first place.
Yeah. Right? It's funny, right? No, sometimes we'll like actually say like, this is not even what we start. Now, the unfortunate part, because I would love for that to be like, oh man, we tripping. Let's mm-hmm. go. Let's mm-hmm. kiss and, you know, get some hot chocolate. Mm-hmm. It doesn't always go that way. But just the recognition, and I encourage you all to just pay attention to the conversations you're having, because just the recognition that you kind of slid off to something else should give you a bit of pause and be like, wait a minute, what are we doing, right?
Yeah, but mm-hmm. it also can be an indicator. It can mm-hmm. also signal to you that there's some unresolved stuff.
True.
That there's something that keeps coming up every time, regardless mm-hmm. of what we're talking about, mm-hmm. right? So it's like carrots, right? So say carrots is the thing.
Yeah.
And so we start having a conversation about baking a cake, and we're talking about all of the ingredients in the cake. And I'm saying, okay, you need to put butter in there, it's flour and sugar. And you say, well, what about the carrots? And I'm like, what about the carrots? And you're like, well, the last time we were trying to do something, it, you know, I said we should put carrots in mm-hmm. it. And then it's like, what does carrots have to do with what we're doing right now?
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of how it is.
That's funny.
Yeah.
That's a funny.
That's a meme. I don't know. But I mean, that's how it happens, because it's usually something that it's like you stop. Mm-hmm. Like what?
And another thing, carrots.
What did you just say? I mean, how did we get here?
You know what? Mm-hmm. Maybe that can be kind of our code. Like you and me for now. Maybe I'll just come up with a code. Like when you know, it's like, man, we are tripping right now. I don't know what we're talking about. I could be like, baby, carrots. Yeah, that'll be fun. That might, you know.
Yeah, it might bring some light to sometimes gets heavy. So, you know, yeah. when we argue, and yes, we argue more than we'd like, but when we're having an argument, they're usually pretty epic. I mean, and what I mean by epic is long.
Pretty long. Longer than I might expect. So, first, there's phases to the argument, right? First, there's like the initial thing.
Silence.
Well, silence. Before silence comes, some type of a something, some statement, ooh, something that gets somebody on the wrong edge of their mood, right?
Yeah.
And so generally, I think we both know when that moment hits.
Yeah, because we can feel it. And so as much as we try to act like we can't feel it, we absolutely feel when something is not right with the other person. And so then it's like, what now? Karen. Tamisha Killock Carter, thanks for joining us. And Lisa McNeil, so glad you could join
us. What's up, sis?
Yes. And thanks you guys for starting your watch parties too. If you think somebody else can benefit from what we're talking about, please invite them. Start a watch party. Let's get this thing going and keep the conversation going. Mm-hmm. So yeah, so it start for us. It always starts with okay, I can feel that something. Yep. There's something there. It's kind of hanging, mm-hmm, right? And then everything just, it gets added to like the flavor of everything, you know? And so then the exchanges become a little bit shorter, and then it's like, that's new.
Keep talking.
and then it's like, okay. So as we decrease the amount that we're talking, the tension is increasing. So it's going like this. Then there's more and more tension until we reach a point where it's just like, okay, we have to talk about this. Whatever it is, we need to talk about it. And then that usually starts with, well, you know, is there something that you want to say? Is there something on your mind? Yeah. Something we need to talk about?
No, not really. Right. Yeah. So, but that moment, the timing on it kind of varies. Mm-hmm. Right. Because it can, literally, there have been times it can go like days.
Yeah.
And apparently, there's times when it's going like weeks or whatever, I'm not sure, but it's like, yeah, that thing. And so, don't recommend that, by the way,
no,
because, you know, when it's like, oh man, you know, I done messed around, I stepped in it, something's happened or whatever, I'm mad. And you know, that it's not going to be an easy thing to get that resolved, but you know, dragging it out, it just doesn't help anything. Anyway, so every now and then it'll drag out. But I remember we were at in Florida last week.
Oh,
the water. No, I'm not gonna talk about. Well, anyway, no, I'm talking about the water. How cold that water was.
Oh yeah.
That is kind of how I will approach arguments sometimes, because y'all may not know this about me, but I tell you now, Mike don't do cold water on his body, period.
At all.
Right. Just can't do it. I mean, I'm pretty sure it stops my heart. I'm pretty sure it has done it a time or two. And so,
so dramatic.
Really, anywhere, like I can splash it on my face, but anywhere, chest down.
Oh my goodness.
It's a problem. And so getting into it, you know, it's like you inch and like, you know that it's going to be painful. It's going to feel right. And so knowing that and knowing that you may live through it doesn't mean that I want to jump in there any sooner. Mm-hmm. And remember that lady? Like, yeah, you get one in. Yeah. Invigorated. Yeah, lady, be quiet. Mind your business.
In the water. I'm like, it's, you Wendy know, like, hey, if you just come good. On, you can get in. And no. So then I had an advocate.
This lady comes over like, yeah, you got to do it. You got to and I got a brother and invigoration. And he just, you know, lady, you know what? Mind your business, okay? If you're watching this lady, mind your business.
No.
Okay?
It was great because she even had an illustration. I'm like, this is like therapy right now.
I told her, I was like, I mean, are you going to send an invoice for this coaching session that you're doing right now? Anyway.
It was good. She was encouraging you.
And I did not need it.
As you hesitated.
I don't need encouragement. All right? Go encourage your nephew. Or say, I don't need encouragement. Yeah. I know me. No, don't do that. Oh, girl. No.
So here's the thing.
I'm sorry. Anyway.
even with us, right? So why there is usually that silence as the tension is building. So Lisa, I figured you might say that, right? So silence, that silent tension building time period is kind of worse sometimes than just kind of talking it out. Yeah. But it really does depend on your personality. It depends on, you know, how you communicate. And so some of us are verbal and we're extrovert and we are extra. I mean, that's the whole point, right? Mm-hmm. And you want to just talk, let's talk and keep pushing it and talking and you just talking and talking and talking. And if some of us are just like, just give me some time to process this and think about it.
Process.
We can talk about it.
We talked about the whole getting processing time before, right?
Yeah.
So
when you talk about the urgency that surrounds just kind of talking about the thing or getting to it, the urgency is different depending on the person. But I think we can both agree, introvert or extrovert, that it is better to go ahead and address something and discuss it and not let it linger.
Yeah, because silence, people fill the blanks in with silence. They can't help it. And so whether they're filling it in with what you're thinking or they're filling it in with what, what I'm thinking and just ruminating on, it's silence, you know, externally, but there's a lot of things happening.
Yeah.
And so we're talking about staying on the main thing. All of a sudden, over the course of time, not only are you not addressing the main thing, but all other things pop up because you're still with a human being.
Yeah.
And living with people is like hard, y'all.
And things continue to happen.
That's what I'm saying, right? Mm-hmm. And so it's like they continue to be themselves. And now the little thing that maybe you would have overlooked now becomes a big deal. You off the main thing, right?
Yeah.
And so it's important to get to that thing very quickly. Mm-hmm. And I almost treat it like, you seen that movie Outbreak?
Yes.
Is that the one, isn't it Outbreak where somebody gets some Ebola? Disease? And then they hop on a plane and it's just like all over, right?
Yeah.
All over the world because nobody got on it when they had an opportunity to.
Right.
And so
you're talking about, like an epidemic and the spread.
Epidemic.
Yeah. So Kim Aiken, thanks for joining us. Candace Terrell says, silence hurts me more than it hurts my husband. I think he likes the peace of mind. I think he likes the peace of mind when I'm frustrating myself because I'm so used to talking to him about everything.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Xavier Lucky Sr. says, so at what point in time does one humble themselves to have a peace resolution?
Well, he does it again. Xavier Lucky Sr.
That's good. That's good.
So people, this is the point at which we pivot, as they say.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody says it, but that's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
Because what is the main thing really, right? And as you all been listening to this for more than a day, you know that our approach to this thing is really more of a biblical approach, right?
Yes.
I mean, because this biblical basis of marriage is where we're coming from. So Galatians 5, 20, 22 and 23, right? Mm-hmm. The fruits of the Spirit, you've probably heard of these. And so, and there are two key ones when I'm trying to challenge myself about what I'm doing, how I'm doing it, how I'm speaking, how I'm feeling and thinking even, I will tend to go to that one. And I also tend to go to 1 Corinthians 13, right?
Okay.
And so that's kind of the love chapter. And so I believe what those two together do is really begin to teach us about what the main thing really is, right? The main thing really is that we are both imperfect people, that we are going to mess up, they're going to make mistakes, that there's going to be problems.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be things that we don't like, et cetera.
Yeah.
Right. But the challenge is, what are you demonstrating? What are you pouring out? Right. It's not about what am I getting? It really becomes about what am I feeling? What am I pouring out? Right. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at the fruits of the Spirit, right, it's love, it's joy, it's peace, it's patience. Yeah. It's goodness and faithfulness, and
kindness,
self-control,
gentleness. I think that's it.
Right?
Yeah.
So if that's what you're doing on a regular, it's just really hard to mess that up.
Right. If you came up with your own fruit and it's not those fruits. And I say that kind of lightly and loosely, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because we sometimes rationalize our behavior.
Yeah.
We say, I'm doing this because you made me this way. Mm-hmm. This is what you caused me to do. I feel this way because of what you did, and you know what to do. You know how to push my buttons. And so when I'm not operating in that place, right, when I'm not, when my actions and my thoughts and my words are not speaking love or peace or kindness or goodness, any of that, then really it comes down to, all of those come down to self-control.
Yes.
You know, so we like to blame other things, people, situations, past experiences, parents. We try to blame everything for why we are the way that we are. But ultimately it comes down to our own control of ourselves in any given moment, not just when things are good, but when things are tough.
Yeah.
And so, that's what I think. That's my summary on that one.
Yeah, I mean, because I think a lot of times when you're upset and you're hearing things that upset you, we will often kind of begin to reach for certain things. Mm-hmm. Hey, Ashley.
Hey, Ashley Key.
Mm-hmm. Hey. We'll begin to reach for things, you know, to make our point or to, like, you know, illustrate how mad, how upset, how hurt, how whatever I really am, right? And so oftentimes, and it happens really quick too. It's just like, you know, things are happening. You're hearing things and you're just kind of creating that list. Mm-hmm. And so how do you avoid that? How do you begin to be in a place where it's not as easy to get off track and to forget that the main thing is really about grace and forgiveness and this expression of love on a regular basis? How do you do that?
I think it's a great question. So what do you guys think? You know, how do you find your way back when you realize that you've created a situation where you're not operating, you know, out of a place of love, or, you know, the arguments continue and you can't figure out how to stop this vicious cycle of having the same argument over and over. You know, when your fruits are more bitterness and resentment and unforgiveness. Mm-hmm. How do you find your way back?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so, and in fact, you know, 1 Corinthians, that part, chapter 13 talks about, you know, it's in there in terms of, you know, things like not keeping a record of wrong. That's a very difficult one.
Yes, it
because
is.
Because once you bring something back, you can say you're not keeping a record of it, but you brought it back.
Yeah.
It came from somewhere.
Yeah.
You checked the record and said, aha, yeah, you remember that thing, right? You're doing it again. Or so that's important. But one thing that I really, really love about that particular one, too, is that we're instructed or, you know, guided to keep, to not rejoice in evil, but to rejoice in truth.
Yes.
Right. And so what is the truth? Mm-hmm. Right. Why are you with your spouse in the first place? Yeah. Right. I mean, what's true about the love that you share and what you are trying to create together? Mm-hmm. What's true about them? Because a lot of times the things that we sling at them, well, it's not them, right? It's not their character. You know, it's there are things that we suggest that aren't true, right? You don't care about me, for example. I've never said that, by the way, but
because not true,
right? But somebody has said that,
that you don't love me,
or things like that,
right? You don't want to be married to me, we start to speak those things and we fill in the blanks. And we're coming from a place of being hurt.
Yeah.
And you know, you've heard hurt people and misery loves company and all that stuff. But the truth is, at our core, what we want is love and acceptance and peace. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to be honest with yourself about what you want your life to be. If you want to live a life of chaos and turmoil and, you know, fighting all the time, then you continue in that way, right? You continue to see things with a very jaded perspective. But if you want something different, then it takes something different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So Ron Harvey had something. Thanks for joining us, Ron and Victoria. We are back talking about fruits of the spirit. Yes. So Ron Harvey says, I think it takes sacrifice versus compromise to allow us to do things that matter for others. God sacrificed his only begotten son. Yeah. Amen. And you know, hi, McNeil, thanks for joining us. Hey. Yeah, when we focus on God's love and what God did for us, that is truly keeping the main thing, right? Yeah. We are unapologetic about talking about and discussing God's plan for marriage. Our belief is that foundationally, you in order for your marriage to survive and succeed and thrive, it has to be based on something greater than yourself.
Yes.
And so when we talk about it and we share scripture and we bring you back to scripture, that's why. Because it's hard. It's hard out here. It's hard to do it. And if you were left to your own, none of us would be together.
Look, marriage, the way that this relationship works, it doesn't make sense, right? It doesn't feel like the thing to do. Intuitively, oftentimes the thing to do just doesn't feel like the thing to do.
Yep.
Because I'm angry and you need to feel my anger and you need to like make up for what you did and you need to, right?
Yeah.
The idea that you would leave with love and leave with forgiveness and grace, and even if you feel insulted, to still come at it with that same love and that same grace. Well, that just doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. But Ron Harvey kind of hits it on the head, though. Sacrifice. So think about it. God gave his son, right? This son will be born in order to die. And the son had to then also take on that. Now, we understand, you know, all right, biblical scholars, you know, don't start calling me about the Trinity. I get it. I'm just saying. So the son comes down. He is man and he is God. But he decides, or he accepts, that death is what he came to do. Mm-hmm. Like torturing, beating, death. He accepted that and walked into that. A lot of us won't walk into the simplest things. We won't put down that little insult that we got, right? We won't let some things go. We won't sacrifice our point, much less our lives. Hmm. So.
Yeah, that's kind of deep.
It's kind of deep. Right. Because but that is what marriage is all about. It is about the sacrifice. It is about taking whatever it is you wanted. Right. Whatever it is you were holding on to, whether that be a grudge or whether that be something that is all about you and not about the one that you married, and taking that and sacrificing that. Mm. Right. So because until you do that, it is all about you, and that's not what marriage is.
Right. And really, I mean, when you really think about it, it's not about us. If you have to, and we've said this before, you literally have to die to self in order to have a fulfilled life, right? In order to be able to walk in the way and to be Christ-like in your walk, you really have to die to self. You can't be selfish in what you're doing. It can't be all about you, what you like, what you want, what you feel, without allowing room for anybody else.
Yeah.
And when we get to this place where we are like, hey, you know that I hate when you do that, but you did it. So now I'm mad at you because you did it. We're not leaving any room or any space for grace.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, okay, so all kind of folks popping up there. Jason, guys, what's up, sir?
Yeah, Sharonda Parker Pringle, thanks for joining us. And Tara Dunn,
hey,
great to see you.
So, this is like really, really, really important. This idea of dying to yourself, and people think about, you know, when they hear it, I'm sure a lot of people are like, no, it's not that serious. Yeah. It is that serious, though, because it's not about a, you know, a death here on the spot, but it's about taking that piece of you that is keeping you from connecting with your wife, brothers, you know, or with your husband, ladies. Mm-hmm. That piece of you that's keeping you from connecting with God, and therefore not being able to kind of see, right, you know, the error in what you're doing or the problem what you're doing, taking that piece and killing that, right? Because once you do that, Mm-hmm. I mean, if you, any of you garden, you know, right? If you take off all of those pieces that are taking the nutrients everywhere what you want them to go, but in effect, you're killing off that piece, but you're saving the core.
Yeah, that's true.
Y'all didn't know I had that gardening knowledge to you, but y'all better come. Y'all better Google me. You better come on through.
Yeah.
So I'm just saying that's.
Victoria Wilson says, sacrificing my point, hashtag conviction. Ashley Key says, I think it's important for us to deal with the matters of our own heart. Mm-hmm. God gives us a model of how we are supposed to be in relationship, and we can always refer to the word and the way we should go. A lot of times it's the matters of our own heart we need to focus on and not the other person it is or isn't doing. Amen. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amen. Preach.
You know what?
Yeah.
So, is there another one up there?
Yeah. I'll go with Ashley. Her last thing was also, I think some of the things that we constantly argue about or things we feel like the other person should or shouldn't be doing is a direct reflection of ourselves. I think self-awareness is a very important part. Yeah. Say that. Yeah. Xavier Lucky Sr. says, we hold on to the right to be right, even if the right ends up upsetting the one we love. So when we do realize it has become wrong.
Man,
like mind blown.
Y'all
on that
are
one.
Like swinging for the fences tonight.
Yes. Y'all getting this?
Playing around on January 20th, 2020.
Yeah, check out those comments. McNeil says, "I know." Oh wait, she says, "I know me. Sometimes I have felt like my love should know better. Then God checked me. He was like, just like I forgive my children when they do things they know better than. Mm-hmm. All I could say was, yes, Lord, gotta have grace."
Gotta have it. Absolutely.
Because, you know, we make the mistake sometimes of making things about us, right? You did this to me, and not really, you know, kind of panning out and just saying, okay, it's just something that you did. Maybe you weren't even thinking about me. Mm-hmm. It had nothing to do with me. You just happened to do it again, but we make it about us. Mm-hmm. And so that can sometimes become a distraction or something that pulls us from the main thing. We are having a conversation or a disagreement or something that needs to be resolved. And yet I'm now focused on what you did, how you said it, what last week was, last month, and 10 years ago. And that's why we're having this discussion right now.
Right. And actually we should comment too. I saw it scroll by pretty quickly, but I think I saw a comment from Victoria that spoke of, she was asking about keeping no records, record of wrongs, but we have a memory, right?
Yes.
Which is true. And so that, I think a lot of people struggle with this idea of remembering things and how am I supposed to just have no record of that? But if you think about it, what a difference is between kind of keeping a record and having a memory of something, right? I don't believe anybody expects that memories will just disappear. There are some memories that will actually fade away, but there are some things that won't, that'll recall them.
Yeah.
But we have a record is like on this day at this hour,
I hereby decree,
check. This is what you did. Right. And you're able to recall that thing like it happened just yesterday. Maybe it was 5-10 years ago, but it keeps on scrolling and it's etched and it's reinforced and it's talked about. Mm-hmm. And ruminated on all the time.
Yeah.
That's more of a record. You understand?
Right.
And so you're able to bring that back with instant recall and then use it against someone, right? Because why do we keep records?
Yeah.
We keep records because we want to be able to prove something happened at a certain point, a certain time. It's evidence.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so, because without a record, people are like, you got no receipt.
Yeah.
It's like you were never here.
Remember that. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, why do we, they have court recorder, court, you know what I'm saying? The person, the stenographers in court, right? Why? Line by line record of everything that happened there.
Yeah. So, and I sometimes feel like we need to have our own stenographer to play back the transcript. I'm like, you know what? We have video of this.
Mm-hmm.
This is exactly as it happened. But the truth is neither of us really recalls exactly how something happened because we're only recalling it from the way that we saw it. You can claim that you do, but he doesn't.
I'd be like on it.
Neither of us has 100% accurate and total recall of what has occurred.
Sketchographic memory, baby.
So when you are willing to extend grace then you're able to receive grace, right? If you keep a record of wrongs, you're not just collecting evidence that you're trying to hold against the person, you're holding yourself hostage to that same evidence. There is a time where you have to let some things go, and you have to let them go for the sake of living a life of joy and peace and love, because that's what we are called to do. We're called to do that and model that for our children and for the other people that are watching this. They watching it. Y'all. They watching. And so, you know, what do you want it to say? What do you want your book to say? How do you read? it is I guess the question that I'm asking. You know, you can say that you're good, but your face is saying that you're not good.
Yep.
You can say that you're good, but your actions are saying that you're not good. Yeah, everything is fine. I'm over it. But, you know, you ask for dinner and I'd like throw something at you. Mm. Yeah, I don't think you're really over it. You know, so as our good friend Ron Harvey says, your audio has to match your video, but that also has to match the transcript.
Oh, snap. Wait a minute. There's a transcript. I thought we weren't keeping a transcript.
Yes. So let's see. Lisa Perry McNeil says, remembering is one thing. Keeping it locked and loaded is altogether there something different. Amen. Yep. And then Victoria Wilson
some
says,
of y'all are like,
oh, wow.
I click out.
She's like,
I'm ready.
Records are to prove something. And she said, I need a Dave Chappelle one on my back. And thanks for joining us, Rella and Terrence Merle. Thanks for joining us. So glad you could join us for a few minutes. So all of you, if you think something that we've shared would benefit someone else, start your watch parties, share our video, share the link. We are Mike and Wendy Perry in the Marriage Shop. And I think that's at the Marriage Shop on Facebook. We are just thankful and blessed and, you know, really humbled that you allow us to invade your homes or your phones every week.
Yeah.
We are on an exciting journey and we want to invite you all to join us on that journey. One of the things that we learned last week is that we need to have a prayer team.
Oh yeah,
we need to have some people praying for us, praying for our marriage, praying for this effort for us. Because as we go out to bring Christ and to hurting people and hurting marriages, we recognize that somebody's not going to be happy about that.
Yeah.
So we want to invite you guys to join us. If you're willing to join us and be on our prayer team, and let us know, just drop it in the comments. Let us know that you'll be on that prayer team. But we need, we're trying to grow. People were telling us they have like prayer teams at 3,000.
I'm like, what? So we need somebody to lead the prayer team, y'all, because I mean, that's a lot of people. 3,000, 330. I mean,
yeah, well, we appreciate those of you who tell us constantly that you are praying for us.
Yes.
But let's make that official.
We got some warriors. We don't even need 3,000, really. We just need, you know, a few folks who might be committed to supporting us in that way.
Yeah.
That'll be amazing because there is much to do you know, this year. There always has been, but the responsibility, the requirements are not becoming fewer, they're becoming more. We believe that prayer works, and that, you know, when a few people are gathered together and they're praying for you, that's profoundly powerful. And I think we'll need that.
Yeah. And I think that's all we need.
Yeah.
Pray for us, pray for our travels, pray for us and our many conflicts.
Oh, you said, I was like, is it like that? We don't have many,
just
got three that we just recycled.
But pray, keep us in prayer and we will do the same. Let us know your prayer requests and we will make sure to by name commit those to prayer as well. So we thank you guys for joining us this week. Is there anything else you need to tell them?
I want to tell them to, well, before I ask for that, for that particular call to action, I just want to say on the topic tonight, and what we'll often do is, and I will certainly do, is put certain things that just see and read and even express certain things consistently on a routine basis, right? And so we're talking about like the fruits of the spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, self-control, mm-hmm. et cetera. We see, put those somewhere where you can see them, read them.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Read them out.
Every day, because we, you know, there was a mention of self-awareness earlier. Mm-hmm. You'd be surprised. Oh, are you all right?
Did
I get you? I'm sorry. You'd be surprised how, just doing something simple like that all of a sudden causes you to zoom out. When you're in the midst of a conversation or an argument or whatever, you'll actually begin to measure yourself against some of those things. Is that what I'm doing right now?
Yeah.
Right. And so just that little bit of self-awareness can really smooth, potentially, you know, kind of bring you down a notch, help to, like, you know, take that edge off your comments, maybe even change your facial expression.
Yeah.
Right. Hopefully what it does is help you to see better, to love a little bit better, right? And to be a better husband or wife to a person that you love most.
Yeah, put it on your lock screen.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good idea. I'm gonna put those on my lock screen, matter mm-hmm. of fact. But what I also want you all to do is, we've asked before, and we'll continue to ask from time to time, is we like your email addresses, because we're creating this email list. We're gonna be sending out a newsletter. Mm-hmm. We're gonna probably need that as we begin to organize this prayer team. And I say we begin to organize it. I wasn't joking. I need somebody to lead that. Need help. But just send us your emails. You can send them, you know, direct message. You can put it wherever. If you don't mind, you know, everybody else seeing it, you can plug it in here in the comments. But send us your contact information. We want to reach out to you and just kind of, you know, connect with you on some different ways. And
Yeah.
So 2020, it's going to be amazing. So
I'm
glad to be there with you.
Yeah. I'm glad to be there with you. Or were you talking about them?
2020. You know what them, but I mean, y'all, you obviously, you. I mean,
okay.
First, I mean, y'all,
yes.
Okay.
So to keep you guys, dialed in on what we're doing next, that helps us, and we can get that out to you. As you know, February 14th, we'll be, celebrating with the folks from Gardner Grove Baptist Church at the Doubletree. And so we'll be doing, speaking at their Love Connection event. So you're welcome mm-hmm. to join us. We dropped that event on this page, so you can check out the details on that. If you're interested, contact Thomas Stokes, I think. Mm-hmm. But the contact information is on there. And then we'll be in Myrtle Beach the weekend of February 28th to March 1st. That'll be our first time officially joining the Weekend to Remember team. And so,
if you want to wait, it's fine.
No, God's got it. We're excited about it. If you're not able to make it to Myrtle Beach, then in May, we'll be in Atlanta. So that first weekend in May, we'll be in Atlanta. So we're excited about it. We look forward to it, bringing how God has healed us to many and more. So we're allowing him to use us, and thankful mm-hmm. that you allow us every week to share some things with you. So
it's Trey Cherry. What's up, cuz?
Okay, hey Trey. So when you disconnect tonight, take a minute to think about whether or not you're operating in the fruits of the spirit. And also, the next time you have a disagreement, make sure you keep the main thing the main thing. That's all I have. You want to pray for them?
Yeah, let's pray real quick, y'all. We'll let you go. Heavenly Father, we just come this evening just thanking you for your goodness and for your grace, and thanking you for the example that you've given us through your word and through your actions about how to be more forgiving, about how to sacrifice, how to die to oneself in the interest of something that is greater. And so we just ask that everyone who hears this, help us to love better by modeling you. Help us to love sacrificially, and help us to demonstrate love, joy, peace, kindness, gentleness toward one another. We believe that changes relationships, it changes marriages, and it changes the world. So we thank you, and we love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Have an amazing week, and we will see you guys next week on Monday at 7 or 8.
She said 7. I mean, you know, 7 is the goal, y'all, but hey, you know, listen, I mean, life. All right.
Yes. Have a good week.
Have a good week, everybody. All right. Bye. We'll see you soon.
Yes. Thank you.
like forever that I have waited for you. In a world of disappointment, one thing is true. God has blessed me, and he's blessed you too. In a world of lonely people, I found you.